So, who did it right? Who won?
All of them. I mean, we love the fact that they're all doing it together. So, you know, that's absolutely key because we love to see them competing now for cash return. And we're talking about a virtuous circle here, you know. Mm-hmm. So when the entire industry gets into this dividend competition, they're also taking money off the table that would otherwise probably be spent on CapEx. So they can then get the commodity into a virtuous circle as well.
What's the issue, though, when you are unable then to spend the money to, say, stem decline rates or offset the decline rates? Does that become then a why is your production growth falling issue, or are we not there?
No, we're not, because they're still all growing at double digits. Mm-hmm. You know, our argument was that they don't need to grow at 15% plus. You know, that's way beyond what the oil market is growing. It's way beyond what's needed by the market, essentially. So they're able to cut back and still grow. But you make an excellent point, which is that unlike refining, where we had a similar, if you want, attack on the industry in terms of overspending and lack of cash return, the refineries just sit there, so you don't need to spend to grow or stand still. You can actually just more or less harvest cash. And that's a really nutty problem that you've referenced, is the how do you balance cash return with you know, maintaining your volumes and growing your volumes as an E&P.
Growing, maintaining your volumes to then get the cash flow to then fund your dividend so
exactly.
You don't have to borrow and then keep your debt low.
Exactly.
So it's a very tricky balance for these guys.
It is.
When you take a look at the coverage world that you have, like who is doing it totally right, who still needs to improve, who's doing it wrong?
Pioneer, we think, sort of leads today's, and if you like, this week. We've called it Permian Week, mm-hmm. and they've done very well. They had great call today with Scott Sheffield, also talking about ESG, and all of them, in fact, are doing the right thing in terms of their ESG messaging, more or less. But generally speaking, the focus of the Permian plays, Parsley, Concho, Diamondback, are all getting it right in our view now, and, mm-hmm. and are really well located in terms of their assets and what they can do. Our argument always was that these companies have the best industrial opportunity that they've had for the past 50 years. The problem's been their strategy. So we're thrilled to see the strategy is coming right. And this is not just a special, you know, we're looking for a sustained performance mm-hmm. here, obviously, because as you know, the dividend yields in absolute terms are still pretty small.
Who's not doing it?
Exxon. Actually, it's crazy to think that when you look back over the cycle, how we could get to a place where we're lauding the US E&Ps for growing their dividends and showing capital restraint, and then be completely an opposite world to have Exxon as being
not doing either.
Quite consciously outspending. Now, of course, we've got the Exxon analyst meeting coming up March 6th, so we'll see if they change, March 5th, I should say. We'll see if they begin to back off that strategy, but it's not really their style to commit in the way that they have and then change direction.
100% true. So when you look at the underperformance, and we just have sort of the US E&Ps versus the oil price, so just focus on that. If you look at that underperformance, when does that start to turn around? Like, is this actually enough to draw in investors who have been so burned by this space?
You know, I was speaking to one of our senior salesmen, David Miller, on the West Coast, and he was saying that he was decided to go with our message yesterday to investors on the West Coast and to talk about our Napa conference in late March, and he got no responses whatsoever.
Hmm.
So his, you know, that there's two ways of looking at that. For a Wall Street guy with his experience, he sees that as a very powerful sign. That is to say, we're clearly bottoming,
mm-hmm.
and the fact that people aren't chasing these stocks in any way, shape, or form makes this a great opportunity, I think, to start looking at a long-term investment.
Do you also need to distinguish which players have heavier oil versus gas, considering that flaring has been such a contentious issue, as well as takeaway capacity, and as well as having to take write-downs on your gas assets? That's particularly in Appalachia. Like, how do you see that?
Yeah, all the above plus the price. I mm-hmm. mean, you had Cimarex talking about an assumption of 5 cent Waha gas prices. That's 5 cents per MMBTU. You multiply by 6 per BOE. So you're talking about 30 cents a barrel of mm-hmm. oil equivalent. Mm-hmm. I mean, in crazy numbers. So there's the price and all the issues that you said. And yeah, absolutely. All of the guys that we're talking about that would be the Pioneer, the Fang, the Diamondback, the Concho, all those guys have a very high oil cut, relatively speaking, led by Pioneer.